God has done great things for us, whereof we are so very glad. We want you to be excited with us, whether you're here in the sanctuary, whether you're listening or watching. Get excited to take a trip into God's Word, to learn of Him, spend time with Him, grow in Him. The very erudite Reverend Henry Giles is going to be sharing with us the illustrious, helpful Word of God. At this time, our music ministry is coming to bless us. Let's get ready to receive what the Lord has in store for us.
Tragedies are commonplace, all kinds because of diseases, people are slipping away. The economy's down, people can't get enough pay. But as for me,
church family, visitors, and friends. The scripture reading this evening will be coming from Psalms 134. Behold, bless ye the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, which by night stand in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and bless the Lord that made heavens and earth, bless the Lord out of Zion. That's Psalms 134, 1 through 3.
Good evening. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come into our presence once again through our Son, Christ Jesus. We come thanking you, Father. We ask that you forgive us our sin. Father, we ask that you look down on heaven, each and every one, listening, those that are present. Father, for whatever reason their needs may be, we ask that you may grant it. Father, that you would put them in your arms of protection. Father, most of all, we ask that you look down on our brothers and sisters in their time of need, those that have been through the hurricane, those that have fallen short, those that are destitute, Father, those are that without homes or food or whatever it may be. Father, we ask that you send your protection angel to comfort them. Father, we ask that you look down on the sick and the bereaved. Lift their heart, Father. Protect them and keep them, Father, for we know these days come, but most of all, we know you have the hope. Father, we ask that you bless each and every minister that makes up this congregation. Father, we ask that you bless the one that will bring the world, that it be fresh and that it will fall on rich soil. Father, continue to keep us and lift us, Father. Continue to, Father, let us not be selfish in these times. Most of all, Father, we lean not to our understanding, but seek you in all that we do. And we ask that you order our steps. Father, I ask that you continue, Father, to thank us as we come into this new month, that we would do better, ask for more, and continue to, Father, to seek you, because we know now that these are the dark days, but it's not that we would be without the light, but you are the light. Father, we just said that through it all, it's good to have the Son that went to the Calvary, Father, and it died, but most of all that he got up. And we thank you for that he sits on the right-hand side of the Father, interceding for a sinner like myself. Father, we just want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. And continue to bless and keep your people that only that you can. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take everything. I don't want it. I don't need it, God. Take everything. I don't want it. I don't need it, God. I just want you. I just want you. I just want you, yeah. I just want you. We just want you. We just want you. We just want you. We just want you. Oh God, so take everything. I don't want it. I don't need it, God. Oh, take everything. I don't want it. I don't need it, God. I just want you. I just want you. I just want you, yeah. I just want you. We just want you. We just want you. We just want you, yeah. We just want you. God, so take me. I'm yours. Take me. I'm yours. I just want you. I just want you. I just want you. I just want you. Nobody but you, Lord. And I just want you. We just want you, Lord. We just want you. We just want you, yeah. We just want you.
I just want you. I don't need all the other stuff. I just want you. Good evening. Welcome to our Wednesday night worship service. As we travel through the Word of God to just want to enrich somebody and to perhaps change somebody's life. I am Reverend Henry Giles, one of the associate ministers here at the Pleasant Hill Baptist Church, and I will be bringing a lesson this evening. I have a title here, and ironically, Sister Moore, it says that all we need, I just think that's strange. I just want you. My title is All We Need. I would like for you, if you would, to open your Bibles, get your notepad and your pencil and any electronic device that you may use during your study period, and follow along with what we're going to be saying this evening. The Word of God just seemed come across so differently as the minister read, and you can sit there and look at your Bible and know what he's saying is actually there. Sometimes people will tell you stuff that's not there, so we have to be careful. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 is what we're going to be traveling through on this evening. Of course, this is a letter by Paul. He wrote it to the church in Corinth as he was in Ephesus. Corinth was a troubled community. It was troubled because people in Corinth had a real problem getting along with each other. Please, Usher, you may be seated, please. They had a real problem getting along with one another, and a lot of it was due to the fact that you had some rich and you had some that was very poor. And a lot of faction come into the situation, schism. People thinking that they were more than others because they had more than others. So Paul had to address this situation since he's the one that established this church in Corinth. And after he left, while he was in Ephesus, Chloe sent word to him by some of her people that there was a lot of problems there. So Paul did what any good, may I use the word pastor, would do. He addressed it. It takes a very certain kind of man, special kind of person, to address a situation that's going on within the church. A lot of time they don't want to do it because it could cause somebody not to like them very much. I'm just telling the truth. That's all I'm doing. Somebody gonna dislike them because Deacon Coleman, he pulled somebody's coattail or shirt tail and remind them that they should not be acting in the way that they are acting. You shouldn't be carrying yourself in the way that you carry yourself. You should not be conducting yourself the way that you are conducting yourself. Why not? Because it's not godly. They knew the God truth, and they knew it because Paul had given it to them, but yet, because they decided that they were going to listen to others come in and give them a lie, they decided we're going to go with the lie. But Paul had told them the truth. Can you imagine yourself in Paul's situation, knowing that you have done all that you could possibly do within the realm of righteousness, and yet they turned and they apostatized. They turned their back. I'm not talking about in the world. I'm talking about in the church. I'm talking about in the ecclesia. I'm talking about the assembly. This is the assembly. This is a local assembly, and this is where we come to praise and worship the Lord. This is where we come to have fellowship with one another. Because it is the house of prayer, and it has been so ordered because it was dedicated to be the house of prayer. I was here when this church had its dedication service. And I know what the preacher said. I was here. So the thing is, we have to learn. We need to stay with the word of God in everything we do. And that's what Paul's point is. Stay with the word of God. I'm the one that established you, and he's not bragging, but I'm the one who brought you the word in the first place, and you received it gladly. He says to the church in Galatia, who have bewitched you that you do not do the truth? Who have bewitched you? Who did it? Question that's worth answering. We are in a situation right here, Pleasant Hill. We're in a situation. Now, how the situation turn out, guess who it depends on? I'm going to say God. But see, we got to be in the deciding factor also. Am I willing to do it the way God say do it? Or am I going to insist on doing it the way I say do it? Which way am I going to do it? This is not the season for us to turn against each other, to turn around and apostatize from each other. This is the season to remain unified in whatever we do, what we say. This is the season. Because that's the only way we're going to make it. If we stay unified, that was one of their problems. So let me read this. Paul called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God and Sosthenes. I practice that word, and I still said it wrong. Our brethren. Unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be the saints, and all that is in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and our. Let's stop. First, he identifies himself. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, Paul says that. So he identifies himself as to who he is. And once he said who he was, they knew exactly who it is that's writing this letter to them. Paul, used to be Saul, Paul, knocked down on the Damascus Road, Paul, the one that saw light from heaven, Paul, the one that went to Arabia for 3 years, Paul. They knew who it is, so they didn't have a problem with that. Maybe that's why Paul is attempting to approach them with such, should I use the word, leniency? A better word, with love. He had every right to rebuke them sternly for what they, he's their apostle. He could have jumped all over all of them in that local congregation. I said something then, local congregation. Pleasant Hills are a local congregation. That's all that means, local congregation. Mount Canaan, it's a local congregation. Galilee, it's a local congregation. Yet we are a local congregation. It appears that we are apart, but yet us together, what we do is make up the entire church of Christ. The church is not divided. We just have a way to express this is our, could I use our little hole in the wall? This is where we go. This is where I come to praise. This is where you come to praise. They go there, they go there. But this is our local congregation. And they assemble there. Another word for the church. The assembly. That's what it, the church is a group of called out believers. What do they believe in? They believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That's what the church believes. They believe that Jesus lived, died, hanged on the cross, buried, but he rose again on the third day morning. That's what we believe in. They believe that Jesus got on the cloud and went back to heaven where the Father is. They believe that. That's what we believe. They believe that Jesus is coming back again one day, even though we don't know when he's coming back. We believe with everything in us, and we anticipate it. He's coming back. That's what we believe. If you don't believe me, just look up the articles of faith. You'll see that what we believe. We believe it because why? Because the word of God says it's going to happen. So here they are in Corinth with all of the disruption and stuff going on in Corinth, in the local congregation. What they're doing is they are beginning to listen to the facets of society. In this season, let me tell us something. Don't be listening to what they're saying out there. I'm serious. Don't listen. Y'all listen to me. Don't listen to what they are saying out there. Because the first thing is, they do not know what's going on in here, so how can they talk about what's going on in here? If they go to talking about what's going on in here, what you need to do is just gently walk away. Speak to the hand, because the head ain't listening. That's what you need to do. Somebody said this Sunday, didn't they? So you was called to be saints. You was called to be a saint. With all that is in every place, you wasn't the only one called. Listen to what he's saying. You wasn't the only one called, but saints in everywhere else, saints regardless whether in Corinth, Galatia, Ephesus, wherever they are, we're all the same. We were saved not because we wanted to get saved. We were saved because God saved us and we received the salvation. That's what preaching is. That's what the gospel is. Jesus says, go ye into all nations preaching the gospel. That's what it is. Go out there and tell them that Jesus Christ is the way, the only way to get to God. You were called to be a saint. In other words, you sanctified. We all sanctify, so ain't no need to try, no need to get upset with the people that got the tambourines and get loud guitars. Ain't no need. We all are sanctified, every last one of us. We are sanctified, and we are in the process of sanctification. God is trying to get us somewhere. It just takes more time with me than it takes for you. Maybe you're a little bit further ahead than I am, but guess what? You're not there where you ought to be, and you're not where you're going to be. And you're not going to be there until the Lord come back and snatch us up out of here. I said snatch. You're not going to be there until that happens. Verse 3. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace, we know we love that word grace. That is a beautiful word. Because God gave us something we really didn't deserve. No way we could pay for it. No way we could. I don't care how good. I can start right now being the best person. You know how we used to get when we was chewing around Christmas? I can start out being the best person, best person that ever was, but guess what? I still cannot earn what God have given me by grace. So Paul tells them that you were called by grace. And God have given you the peace, his peace. You know that peace that passes all understanding? Jesus told his disciples, he said, my peace I give unto you, my peace I leave with you, not as the world giveth I unto you. Jesus' peace is a legitimate peace. It's a peace, I don't care how bad things get. We just lost my mother Sunday night. Let me tell y'all something. I'm at peace. I'm at peace. People think that's strange. I guess they think I ought to be huffing and puffing and crying and kicking. But when I looked at Mother the same night she died, when we went in to look at her, my mother hadn't looked like herself in years. I walked in there and I looked at her face, and she looked like herself. She did. She looked like herself. There was peace all over her face. I'm at peace now. Okay, I'm going to talk about by the way, thank you all for your well wishes, your prayers, and your condolences. He said, I thank my God, verse 4. I thank my God always on your behalf for the peace, for the grace of God, which is given by Jesus Christ. Paul just did something right there that I need to learn how to be more liberal with. I thank my God always on your behalf. That's good. Not mine, your behalf. There is something about every last one of us sitting up in here, viewing online, listening on the home phone, audio, there is something about all of us that somebody who know them should be able to say, I thank my God for them. Regardless of how bad they might be, or we say bad, but when we stop and look in the mirror, I think it become quite visible that we not all of that. We just think we are. So Paul is writing this letter to a group of people that really he should have been rebuking, but he didn't. Don't be so quick to put people out. Don't be so quick to put people out. That in everything you are enriched by him, in all utterance and in all knowledge. Listen, go back to the topic. All we need. All we need. He's all we need. Now, I know we have to have a relationship and fellowship with one another. We know that. Jesus encouraged fellowship. That's what the disciples was. They had fellowship with him. They had fellowship with one another. Jesus, the Lord, told them in his word to forsake not the assembly. You may not believe it, but I need you. I do. I need you. Guess what? You need me too. We need each other. And that's what makes us the people that God have us here to be, because we realize that life is much better being with people that understand, that believe the same thing that we believe. And I'm talking about the gospel. So Paul writing to them, he want them to know. He want them to understand what he's saying. Again, He could have been rebuking them. You ever had a time when you knew somebody should have been rebuking you, pointing their finger at you, straightening you out because of the way you acting and living, and they didn't? It has a tendency to make you rethink yourself. It has that tendency. That in everything you are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. Your speech, utterance, what you say, what do you say? We're supposed to be speaking the word of God. We're supposed to be speaking the word of God. What do we supposed to have knowledge of? We're supposed to have knowledge of God. Jesus came that we may know God and know him more fuller than they knew him before he came. I know we understand God better now in the 21st century than they did back 2,000 years ago. I know we do. Because we have stayed and we have plowed and we have been taught. We have teachers. We have people that have gone to school and learned this so that they can stand up in the pulpit at the class and explain it. We have people that can do that. So we have knowledge. Knowledge should give us utterance. And we should tell people about Jesus. Verse 6. Even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you came behind in no guilt, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Back to the topic. What's the topic? All I need. All I need. And Galatians chapter 5. And I'm going to close it out after this, I think, yeah. Just to reiterate what Paul is saying to the church in Corinth, let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verses 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, and 31. Let's look at those. Are you there? Okay. Now, ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. And God has set some in the church, listen to this, first apostles, first and secondary prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles and gift of healing, help, government, diversities, the diversity of tongues. This is what God did. That is what Paul is saying to the church in Corinth. You have everything you need. It may not, is not confined in just one individual. It's not. Everything that Pleasant Hill need is not confined in one individual. You do what you do. You do what you do. I do what I do. And if we work together in unity, what God won't done will be done. But we're going to have to work together. We're going to have to. If we don't, we're going to fail miserably because we have stepped out of the arena that God has set forth for us to be in. Diversity of tongue, 29. Listen to Paul here. And I want us to notice something about this verse. You have three question marks in this one verse. He says, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Four different things. He questioned them about. Nobody in this church, no church, can answer yes to all of these questions. I just don't think they can. Apostles. We know to be an apostle, this is what has to take place. When they chose someone to replace Judas, it had to be with someone that was with Jesus during his 3 years ministry and went with him. He was taught, they was taught by him. They learned from him. Actually, Paul is the last apostle. And I know I'm going to get some phone calls on that. But Paul was the last one to see Jesus. Nobody else. Have you seen Jesus? Then I guess you're an apostle. You know him. You may, and I'm saying, and I'm saying you know him. I didn't say you know of him. I say you know him, and you know him because you have a relationship with Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God. You know him. Don't ask me how Jesus looked. I can't tell you. Are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? The answer to all of those is no. Have all the gift of healing? Do all speak with tongue? Do all interpret? Now, here's the key. Because after he goes through all of this, and he's talking to the church at Galatia, but he's also talking to the church at Corinth. He's also talking to Pleasant Hill Baptist Church 2021. He's talking to every last one of us. He's doing it. You have a gift. You have a gift. But the sad part is, many of us don't know what our gift is. We don't. See, we should have been here at that one of Live at Five sessions we had when Dr. Curly White took us through this thing with gifts, gave us a survey that we could fill out and get an idea of what our gift is. A lot of us are trying to function in the church, but we're not functioning in our gift. We're trying to function in somebody else's gift. It don't work. Come on. Am I preaching?
You are preaching.
I ain't supposed to be preaching, though. I'm supposed to be teaching. I do. But gifts, okay. I like telling them. When I go to talk about gift, I like pulling this watch out. See that watch there? That's a gift. Know where I got it from? My wife. She won it at an affair that her former employees had, and she went up there and she picked a box and opened it up. It was a watch. She gave this to me. It was a gift. What would it look like if I never used it, if I never wore it, if I never put it on? Yep, thank you. Unappreciative. That's the way God looked at us and our gifts. Why don't we use our gift? If we use our gift, we can get to that place that God would have us to be at. Why don't we use them? Better yet, find out what your gift is. Find out. Do all speak in tongues? Do all teach? Can all heal? What's your gift? What is your gift? Can I tell you that we have all we need to get through this world? Now, I'm talking about, because this is what Paul is talking about. He's talking about the local congregation. We should never think that we don't have what we need to be the church. We should never think that. Because God have given us all that we would ever need, and that's it. But covet honestly the best gift, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. We all know what that leads to. The love chapter. Listen to me, Pleasant Hill. Listen to me out there on streaming live. If we have love one for another, if we just have love for each other, if we stop hating on each other and putting each other down, stop backbiting, if we just do that, we've done all that God would have us to do. Can I tell you something? You're not going to hurt somebody you love. If you hurt somebody, and I'm not talking about giving your child a spanking. I'm talking about hurt somebody you love, whether it's emotionally, physically, mentally. You're not going to intentionally hurt them. Not if you love them. If you hurt somebody that you love, then guess what? You hurt yourself.
That's good.
So the 13th chapter will take us through this whole thing about love. When you get home, read it. Better yet, Before you read the 13th chapter, read the 12th chapter. Then read the 12th chapter again. Then read the 12th chapter again. Now go over into the chapter that talk about love. We need Jesus. We need to, and I think Paul is making that very quite clear to the church in Corinth. We all need Jesus. If we had Jesus, life would be much better. And I'm not so much dealing with those that have. I'm talking about those that don't have him, who refuse to receive Jesus Christ as their Savior and ask him into their heart to be a Lord. That's who I'm talking about. If you here tonight and you have not received Jesus Christ, this is a good time to do it. This is decision-making time. Perhaps you're out there and you're viewing online, live stream. Perhaps you're listening to this Bible study class on your phone, audio only. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. If you hear the word of God and you receive the word of God, then you can be saved. So if you have heard, and if maybe you're in limbo about it, maybe you are, but if you have heard and you want to give it a try, can I tell you, right now is the best time. All you have to say is, Lord Jesus, I heard what Reverend Giles said, not because Reverend Giles said it. I heard Reverend Giles say what you said. That's all you got to say. I believe it, I receive it, and I render and I surrender myself unto you and you alone. That's all you have to say. Now I would suggest very strongly, you find you a local congregation somewhere where Jesus Christ is being preached and taught. Find one. Go to that church. Talk to someone. Tell them you heard what that man said Wednesday night. And I want to talk to somebody about being saved. I want to talk to somebody. Or if you're local and you live close enough to the Pleasant Hill Baptist Church, get on over here. Get over here. You will be received, and all you have to do is come down when the door is open. I want to receive Jesus as my Savior. I want to receive him as my Lord. And then I want to be baptized. We have a phone number up there, 318-636-6000. Call that number. And if somebody really want, if they want to, they can direct, they can give you my phone, my cell phone number. Call me. I'll talk to you. Try to give you guidance. But the last thing we want to see at Pleasant Hill Baptist Church and any other local congregation, if for somebody to wind up in hell. Minister Boxley taught us a few weeks ago, hell ain't no pretty place. It didn't take the rich man long to be there. He didn't have to be there long before he realized, I don't want to be here. But that's where he was. So if you want to receive Jesus, I would tell you to come. Come. Come to Jesus just as you are. Forget about trying to fix yourself. You can't fix yourself. If you could fix yourself, you would have fixed yourself years ago. You cannot fix yourself. But I tell you what, Jesus can. He really can. Be blessed. In the name of Jesus. Amen. I will close in prayer and benediction. Eternal God, we right now, we're in a struggle. Just about everywhere we turn, it's a struggle. We have to fight. We constantly have to be in argument with people. And a lot of time it's because we're trying to tell them the right thing to do and they don't want to hear it. So Lord God, right now, thank you for your anointing power that keep us moving strongly. And whether they hear it or not, let us keep telling it until they hear. Tell them, tell them. Tell them, bless us. And now, may the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, the communion of the Holy Ghost be with us all. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You are excused.
Generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children.